Hi everybody, I'm Naveen and today I will explain this big data technology and its related services, and I will explain big data on cloud as well. So first I want to start from big data introduction. What actually big data is and how we handle big data and what all tools are available in the market right now for processing huge data and handling this big data, and what's the difference between Hadoop and big data, because a lot of people are confused in Hadoop and big data thing. So first is what actually is big data. So first start with Apache Hadoop. So it's a combination of two layers, MapReduce and HDFS. So these are the two layers in Apache Hadoop. So this HDFS part is my data storing layer. This is my data storage layer, or we can say it's a kind of database that store all kinds of data, whether it is structured data or semi structured data or unstructured data or unstructured data sets. And on top of this is MapReduce. MapReduce is a data processing tool, or you can say ETL tool. ETL tool or data processing tool. Now big data is huge amount of data. It can be in any format. It can be structured, unstructured, or semi-structured. And Hadoop is a tool to handle this huge data. Suppose I have a database. Multiple data sources. Suppose this is Oracle, and I have MySQL, and we can store data from these multiple sources into HDFS. So these sources are structured sources. Now we can store semi-structured data So we can store structured fields on HDFS, or we can store any streaming data. Any streaming data, for example, videos, audio, images. So this is called unstructured data, or we can store semi-structured data like JSON, XML. So we can store this data as well in HDFS. So at the end, the HDFS is just for data storage. And who will process this data in HDFS? MapReduce. This MapReduce tool, it process data from these sources, these available sources, into HDFS. Now, MapReduce is a complete engine. So in this engine, inside MapReduce engine, MapReduce is a wrapper on top of Hive, on top of Pig, on top of Sqoop. These all are wrappers of MR. So this stack is a MapReduce stack. These all comes under this. This is called MapReduce stack. So if we are writing a Hive job, it is converted into MR internally. If we are writing a Pig job, internally it converted into MR. If we are writing a Sqoop job, it internally converted into MR. At the end, everything is converted into MR, and MR Hadoop, because Hadoop understand MR. Outside of this is Hadoop ecosystem. There we have Hive, Sqoop, Flume. Not Flume. Flume is a real-time processing tool. So Pig is here. So these all comes under Hadoop ecosystem. Sqoop. Now everything is converted into MapReduce first. Hive is converted into MapReduce. Sqoop is converted into MapReduce. Pig is converted into MapReduce. Once this job is converted into MapReduce, then it's submitted inside HDFS on HDFS, and then it will process the data. Now, HDFS is a distributed system. It has master slaves. So, if I'm saying HDFS architecture, this HDFS database, it contains master and slave. So suppose I'm saying 4-node Hadoop cluster, it has one master and 3 slaves. So these are Hadoops. These machines act as Hadoop slaves. So suppose this kind of cluster we have. So this is Hadoop master. This machine we call it Hadoop slave one. Or you can say data node. Data node 1. This is data node 2. Data node 2. This is data node 3. And all are connected to masters. And master node is called name node. Now this is the internal structure of HDFS. Okay. Now we can reduce MR with another engine, and that alternate engine for data processing is Spark. So nowadays everybody is talking about Spark. So Spark is another engine. They're also a data processing tool, just like MR. It also has repos, just like this. MR has its own repos. Spark also has its repos. Spark core. Then we have not Spark core. Spark SQL. Spark SQL. Then Spark streaming. Spark streaming. Then we have Spark graphics. Spark streaming. Spark graphics. Spark ML. Spark ML. So these all are wrappers of Spark code. Spark code programming. So everything Spark SQL is converted into Spark code. Spark streaming is converted into Spark code. Graphics, ML, all are converted into Spark code. Now, Spark is available in 4 languages. So we have Python, we have Scala, we have Java, we have R. If we are writing a Spark job in Scala, that we call it Scala Spark. If we are writing Spark job using Python, that is PySpark. Similar manner, if we are writing job in Scala, then we call it Scala Spark. If we are writing jobs in Java, then that is Java Spark. And last one is Spark R. So we have these choices. Now, Spark is designed in Scala. So if we write Scala Spark job, then their performance will be faster because engine is designed in Scala. But if we are writing a PySpark jobs, or Java Spark or Spark R, then it will convert into Scala first, and then job will execute. So there is a internal tool py4j. The py4j tool converts PySpark job into Scala first, and that job will execute it inside the cluster. Now we have three APIs in Spark. First is RDD API. RDD APIs, data frames API, data frame APIs, and third one is your data set APIs. So Spark exposes 3 APIs. Now RDD is resilient distributed data set. Means it's RDD is an object, but this object is distributed. Means distributed means suppose we have 1 gigabyte of data, and we are loading the data into our RDD. So that RDD internally creates the partitions, 128 MB partitions. So yes, it's an object, but it's a partition object that contains data in partition formats. So now, once this object is submitted on Spark cluster, it will process partition across Spark worker nodes. Now, we can create 4 types of application in Spark. As you can see, Spark, as I told you, there are 3 APIs in Spark RDD data frames and data sets. So we can write Spark jobs using RDD APIs in these four languages. Now, if you are writing a Spark job using data frames API, we can write in these four languages. But if you are writing jobs in data sets, then we have these two options, Scala and Java. So now we can create four type of application: batch applications, real-time application, data analytics application, and graph application using Spark. So if you are writing a batch application means the jobs or application which we have to schedule with some kind of schedulers like Oozie, Airflow. There are a lot of schedulers available. So we can schedule these jobs. So those are batch applications. Suppose we are extracting data from a structured database, like let's say Oracle, and we are feeding that data in HDFS on daily basis. So there we have to write a Spark batch job. And we have four options available. Either we can write a Spark RDD program, or we can write the program using data frames, or we can use SQL as well, Spark SQL, or we can use Spark dataset APIs. Now, which one is better? What's the best practice of writing Spark jobs? So performance-wise, performance-wise, if we are writing job in Spark RDD, then it will be faster. Then we have Spark data frames. Then we have Spark SQL. Spark SQL. So if we are writing job using Spark SQL, we have last option, Spark SQL. So if you write job Spark SQL, it will convert it into Spark data frames. Then it data frames converted into Spark RDD. Then finally our job will be submitted on Spark cluster. Spark cluster again, Spark cluster is also similar like HDFS cluster. It's also a distributed environment. So Spark driver, and we have Spark worker nodes, Spark worker node 1, Spark worker 2, Spark worker 3. So if you are writing Spark SQL, yes, we can use SQL queries. So it will be easy to write the job because we are comfortable with SQL programming. But performance-wise, it will be slow because we are adding extra wrappers like this, that this job will be converted into Spark data frames first. Then it will be converted into RDD. And it's an auto conversion. And then this job will be submitted on Spark driver. Now, if you directly write a Spark RDD job, then directly it will submit it on Spark cluster because Spark is designed on RDDs. So there will be no conversion, no wrappers. But RDD is purely based on functions. So suppose we want to perform any transformation functions. Mainly Spark is designed for ETL. And if you want to perform any ETL grouping, sorting, grouping, aggregation, analytics function, then it's not easy because we have to use those functions. But in Spark SQL, we can easily perform the transformations. That's why everybody prefers, most of the people prefer the Spark SQL. Now we have, so as I told you, we can write batch jobs in RDD or data frames or SQL or data sets. So now people are confused in data sets and data frame. So data frame type safe data frame. Data frame which is type safe is equivalent to data set. Type safe data frame. And the data frame which is non-type safe is not equivalent to. So there are two kinds of data frames. First is type safe data frame, and another is non-type safe data frame. So the data frame which are type safe, those are data sets. So it's a data set is an enhanced version of your RDDs. Now next is real-time application. So we can create real-time application using RDD or data frames. So the structure is formalized like this. We have Spark. This part is Spark RDD. So with this we can create batch applications. Now this part, Spark SQL dataset, again we can create batch application but using data frame, SQL and datasets. Now this portion, Spark streaming, this for real time application. And again, if you want to develop a real-time application using data frames, then we call it structure stream. We can create data analytics application as well using Spark ML. This is Spark ML module based on RDDs. And Spark ML module, it is available in Spark 2.x, Spark ML, it based on data frames. And we can create Spark Graph applications. So Spark Graphics is based on RDDs, and then we have data frame that we call it Spark data frames. Now alternate for Spark graph frames is Facebook Giraffe. Facebook also provide alternate for this. Now as I told you, four APIs. So this is PySpark. So we have this core module, this Spark SQL module, this is Spark streaming module, and ML. It's data analytics application but using data frame. And Emblem is again data analytics application but using Spark RDDs. So these are the four APIs exposed by Spark. Scala is also available. Now, next is how to. These Spark clusters and Spark services and Hadoop services are also available on cloud platforms like AWS, GCP, and Azure. So as we can see, these are the services available by AWS. So first we need to understand SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS. Now we have IaaS, Infrastructure as a Service, AWS, Software as a Service, and we have PaaS, Platform as a Service. Now AWS EC2 is Infrastructure as a Service, SaaS, AWS EMR. So AWS EMR is a data lake service. AWS EMR is a data lake service provided by Amazon. Data lake means you have Hadoop and complete MR engine, Hive, Sqoop, Flume, Pig. Data lake service, and there's nothing like PaaS in AWS for big data. Now if I'm talking about Azure, so Azure provides IaaS service, and Azure is Azure virtual machines. And data lake services Azure HD Insights. Azure HD Insight is a PaaS service, and it's a data lake service by Microsoft. And if I'm talking about Google GCP data proc, this is a database service, data lake service by Google. And Google virtual machines is a IWS service provided by Google. Now, as we can see here, we have EC2, it's the infra service. Hence, it's providing the operating system, means the infra. And on top of that infra, we can configure any sort of software. We can set up data lake, we can set up any database, any sort of server. So it provides all these machines on cloud. So there we can choose, suppose I'm choosing this machine, Ubuntu. So in free tier it provides this 1 GB space, and we can, suppose we are configuring a 10 node cluster, then we can say we need 5 machines or 10 machines or 50 machines, whatever, based on the requirement. So suppose I'm saying 5 machines, 1 machine. So by default, it provides 8 GB RAM, security group. One minute. Before creating any EC2 instance, first we need to generate key value pairs. So we can create key value pairs. Suppose test security. First, the key pairs, it provides the key pairs. Now, create an EC2 instance or here on this environment. So launch instance. Select the key pairs. Now Ubuntu machine is available on cloud. Now we have an AWS instance available on cloud. Now via PuTTY we can connect with this environment. First convert the PAM file, because this file format is not supported on Windows. So we can convert it into a PPK file format. Save it. Now via PuTTY we can connect. First the authentication part, this authentication file, and in session we provide the IP address. We can paste that IP here. Now we are connected to AWS machine set up on EC2, AWS EC2 instance. Now here we can set up our Hadoop cluster. So Amazon charges for infra only. It will not charge for the software. So suppose I want to set up a database on cloud, on AWS cloud. So here we can set up our database or any sort of software. So Amazon charges for the infra part. Now suppose AWS, let's install my SQL server, and I'm setting up a MySQL. So this is how we set up a database on cloud, or we can purchase a SaaS service, software as a service for database. RDS is a database service. RDS is a database service. So we can directly purchase this service. So it will Amazon will charge extra for this because it is providing infra as well as software. So these all databases are available. So this is the difference between SaaS and IWS service. That in IWS we have the cloud operator charges for you for the infra, but in SaaS service the cloud operator charges for infra as well as the software install on top of that infra. And platform as a service means we have infra, we have software install of that infra, and our development environment is also available on there. Means the PyCharm for PySpark jobs and Eclipse and IntelliJ for Scala and Java. So the organization, they will pay for the licensing cost. If we have a PaaS service, then there's no need for the licensing because everything is available on the cloud service. You have infra there, you have servers there, you have development IT there. So as you can see, your MySQL database is ready. Now we can set up Hadoop cluster here, we can set up Spark cluster here. So in a similar manner, GCP provides these services. So here we have this VM instances. This is like AWS EC2. And so on this we can set up a VM instance. We can set up a machine here and we can configure our environment. Now data lake service is AWS EMR. So this is a SaaS service. So if you purchase this, then just fill this form. How many nodes of cluster are required? It's 200, 300, whatever. We can fill according to your requirement and then create cluster, and your Hadoop cluster is ready automatically. So we have two choices: on AWS or EC2 we can do, or either we have AWS EMR. Similar case with Azure, we have so Azure we have virtual machines. It's just like EC2, and if you purchase HD Insight, then it's a data lake service, but it's PaaS. Hence, your development ID is also available here. And if we pick any service from Google, then we have Dataproc. Dataproc service is this one. Dataproc, not data flow. Dataproc. So this is data lake service provided by Google. So so as I said, two engines, MR engine and Spark engine. We have these two. This complete environment is, you can say, ETL. So everybody is a little bit aware of Informatica and other CTL tools. So those ETL tools are used for structured data and mainly in data warehousing pipelines. Now we have different sort of ETLs that work on any kind of data, structured, unstructured, semi-structured, and we can process huge data with these ETLs. So these are modern day ETL tools, and so many years we are using these Informatica. So Informatica on Parallel data, we have we have different ETLs available. So they are for data warehousing, but they are not dealing with the big data. And these ETLs deal with big data because of these environments, because of these distributed environments. Spark has its distributed environment. Hadoop also has distributed environment. So first, when these ETL tools extract data, they create chunks of data, and those chunks are processed through the different nodes of the cluster. So we need to cover these ETLs, whatever ETLs is available. If I'm saying Hive, so in this stack, Hive is most popular because Hive is based mainly on SQL. So usually we prefer Hive because we can write those ETLs in SQL. But again, Hive will convert it into MR. So you're a little bit slow, not that much slow, but yes, it will convert into MR internally because Hadoop understands MR. In a similar manner, Spark. So Spark process data in memory. MR data processes data in inside disk. So Spark is way ahead of MR. And now upcoming tools like Presto and others, alternate for Spark is coming in the market. For real-time applications, Storm is there. Storm is also available. We have KStream. We have Beam, we have Flink. So these all are alternates of Spark streaming. Spark streaming, real-time application. So we can write create application using Spark streaming or using these frameworks as well. So in the next session, I will explain things in detail. The internals of Hive, Sqoop, Hive, and the internal memory and the job submission architectures of Spark. And then in the upcoming session, we will see how we deploy Spark and MR jobs on Hadoop and Spark clusters, and how we do the resource management using Yarn, Mesos, and Kubernetes. In the upcoming webinars, I will explain more on that part. I hope you understand this Spark and MR thing, that these all are ETLs and these are advanced ETLs. You can correlate these things with the previous the parallel ETL tools like Informatica and others. So those ETL tools are also used for ETL purpose, for data cleaning, data pre-processing, data transformation, and then loading the data for in data warehouse for reporting. In a similar manner, Spark, MR and Spark, these two engines are the replacement of, you can say, are the alternates for those ETLs. And they process structured, unstructured, or any kind of data, but then we required all languages for different data sets. So we have Python available, we have Java available, we have SQL available. So based on the feasibility, based on the expertise, they can choose either language, and we will do the optimization, and we will do the data processing task within these tools. So this is the just a high level overview about these MR engines. People are a little bit confused about comparing these two engines. Okay, fine. So this is all I have for this session. So we will meet in the upcoming sessions.